It's a differential amplifier. It's a long-tailed pear. It's an analog comparator. It's many things. But the one thing it's not is explained well by the internet. Once again, I have spent forever trying to understand this blasted thing. And what is the one thing that finally tips the scale and gives me a functioning circuit? A YouTube video. One little YouTube video. So now I'm bringing that total up to two. Here's a pro tip for anybody on the internet trying to explain something to someone. Sometimes it helps to actually tell them what parts you're using, such as when the resistor values and their ratios matter, maybe tell them what they are. So a differential amplifier. A regular amplifier has a signal, and it makes that signal bigger. A differential amplifier takes two signals, and it amplifies the difference between them. Let me illustrate. So let's say you have a signal. It's just a little signal. And let's say you used a regular amplifier, such as a common emitter amplifier. You might get something like this. And it might be inverted or whatever, you know, and it might be biased up. But the point is, you're getting a bigger signal out of it. Now, if you used a differential amplifier on a signal like this, you would get the following. The same thing. Because this signal is referenced to negative, to ground. A differential amplifier is amplifying the difference between two signals. So one of your signals would be the varying voltage and the other would be your reference voltage. The difference between them is positive, negative, and so it's amplified. And this is certainly one way to use this and one way to use the operational amplifier, which is why we're studying the differential amplifier. That's step two. So in actuality, let's say you had two signals, perhaps like this. Let's say you have a wave kind of like this, and let's say you have a tidal wave that goes up and down like this. Do you see a similarity between these? If you were to take this minus this, or this minus this, or whatever, you can see how this one is a wave that's being shaped by this wave, right? You know, our Fourier transformation, Fourier series, all that stuff. So this is a composite wave. So your differential amplifier would probably give you something like this, and it would probably be bigger, but you get the point. Here, I'll make it a little bigger, just to say, hey, it's also amplified. But you could see if you took a wave like this, this little wave, and you added this wave to it, what you would get is this wave wiggling like this wave. And then it's this but bigger. So that's what a differential amplifier does, is the difference between these two. This is common to both, and it brings out the difference. So let's say you have wave A and wave B, and at any particular point, let's say wave A is 3 volts and wave B is 2 volts. So let's say that this is your positive side and this is your negative side. We just decide which one when we wire it up. So side A is positive and side B is negative. So the result would be 1 volt before amplification. That's the difference between them. If you had 2 and 3, the difference is negative 1 volt. If you had 3 and 3, the difference is 0. At one specific point, if these are the voltages you have, then this is the difference between them, and this is essentially the input, quote-unquote, to the overall model of the circuit. This is the conceptual input. And then you have a certain amount of gain that is going to amplify the points overall. And this is also why it's called a comparator. If you've ever studied computer programming, you may have come across a comparator function, like if you're trying to sort a list. You compare two values, and if it's positive, then this one's bigger. If it's negative, this one's bigger, and if it's zero, they're equal. Same thing here. So this is the circuit equivalent of the programming construct of a comparator. So you recall this simple common emitter amplifier I've talked about in the past. Don't worry about the input-output bias and all that stuff. Let's just talk about the amplifier part itself. You have your positive connection, your resistor, your output spot, your transistor, your emitter resistor, and your connection to negative. The input is the base of the transistor. The output is this voltage, and it's inverted. A small change in the base is going to get you a large change in the output in terms of voltage. So what if we just stapled two of these things together? Let's take another positive connection, another resistor, another output, another transistor, and share the resistor. So we have these hooked up in parallel, just like so. And this would be output 1, this is output 2, and we have input 1 and input 2. This is a differential amplifier, a long-tailed pear, an analog comparator. And this is where most people, in fact all but one, on the internet stopped and said, well, here you go. They don't talk about the resistor values, they don't talk about the differences between BJTs and MOSFETs, they're just like, well, here it is. Now go ask your professor if you need more. So let's fill in the blanks. The idea of this circuit is that you have a change in one of the inputs. Let's say input one goes up. That is going to change the voltage drop here, but it's also going to change the voltage drop here. So if you have your inputs and your outputs, you're going to swing the input a little bit, and the output is going to swing more proportionally. It's still inverting, so it's flipped upside down, just like the regular common emitter amplifier. But who cares? You can flip it again if you need to. This input 1 is positive. This input 2 is negative. This output 1 is negative. This output 2 is positive. That does not mean the voltages have to be positive or negative. It just means, conceptually, this, like, if you say 3 minus 2, then you get 1. If you say 2 minus 3, you get negative 1. So your positive is sort of the one you're taking from. So if you have A minus B, I1 would be A and I2 would be B. You're subtracting I2 from I1. That's the positive and negative. And then the output is just the opposite. If you measure from positive to negative as your voltage result, not reference to ground, not reference to this, it's differential, just like the H-bridge. Remember the H-bridge? Where you had the output in the middle on its own, not reference to ground? Same thing here. Output 1 and output 2 are your two points, and the voltage across them is the result. And this one's positive and this one's negative because, for example, if I1 was 3 volts and I2 was 2 volts, then output 2 might be 1 volt and output 1 might be 0 volts. So if you apply the voltages there, subtract I2 from I1, and then you measure from O2 to O1, you get positive when I1 was bigger, negative when I2 was bigger, and so forth. And then, of course, your gain. There's a gain there. But the point is, that's the direction you measure from. So how is this magical feat accomplished? When you change this transistor's biasing, you end up changing this one's too? No, you end up changing this resistor's. And the way you accomplish this is the shared resistor. The shared resistor, in this case, is not necessarily a resistor. That's the easiest way to do it, and that's the way I've done it. But there's all kinds of different ways. The idea is this is a constant current element. Some say constant current source. It's not a source, it's a sink. The current's going out at the conventional current. But the point is, through this resistor at all times, to have the perfect differential amplifier, you should have a certain current, an exact current, running through this resistor, or this spot, whatever's here, whatever thing is here, whatever circuit is here, should always be flowing a certain amount of current. No more, no less. It shouldn't go up, it shouldn't go down. And there's fancy ways to do it. One way to do it is to have a large resistor, to have a large voltage drop across it, so that other voltage drop changes in the circuit don't affect it very much. If this is 5 volts dropped across it, and you're varying this by a couple hundred millivolts, then these are going to be changing, and it's not going to affect this as much. So having just a big resistor here can do it. Another way to do it is to have a transistor here. You have a transistor like an NPN, and you apply a certain constant current into the base, which means it's open so far. And the idea is it's going to always let through that much. And then you've got more complicated circuits that, or more complicated devices even, that give you an exact current source. But all you need to remember is this is constant current. And so the idea is if I1, if the voltage here goes up, this transistor is letting through more current through here. But this is letting through the same amount, so this one has to be letting through less. Now, I'm actually going to make a change, and I'm not going to use BJTs here. You can absolutely use BJTs, but you have to make sure the inputs are extremely high impedance. You have to make sure this is a true constant current source. When I set it up, there was all kinds of feedback and weird stuff. Not feedback, but it basically was goofy. But when I used MOSFETs, I didn't have that problem. I just used two N-type NFETs, if you want, or NMOS. Two NMOS, which when you use them this way are drop-in replacements for NPN BJTs, just like the P is a drop-in replacement for the PNP. So now there is incredibly high gate impedance, and it's a lot more controlled and blah. So this is easier, more fragile because they're MOSFETs, but it's easier. So I'm going to do it this way. So when you increase the voltage at the base, at the gate in this case, the NMOS opens more. It allows more current through. So there's more current going through this resistor. This voltage drop goes up, which means this point goes down, which makes sense because this is negative, right? This is our bottom. So if the thing that we are subtracting from gets bigger, if 3 minus 2 becomes 4 minus 2, then we expect our difference to get bigger. So the bottom goes down. So that works. You know, you've got it set here and just the bottom moves, the bottom goes down, so it's bigger now. The difference is bigger. The same thing here. If I2, which is the thing we're subtracting from the other thing. It's the 2 in the 3 minus 2. If we increase the voltage here, then we are subtracting a bigger number from the original number. So more current goes through here, which means more current goes through here, which means this voltage drop goes bigger, this point goes down, and this point is the top of the output. So because we're subtracting more from the number, then the result goes lower. So the top goes down. Bottom goes down, the result is bigger. Top goes down, the result is smaller. And the constant current source means when this current goes up and this voltage drop goes up, this current goes down, this voltage drop goes down. And it's exactly the opposite if we decrease instead of increase the values. I have set up my circuit as follows. I have a 9-volt supply going that way, so that's connected to the positives. I'm using 10K resistors. These are the values I saw in that YouTube video that seemed to work for me, because I was under the impression, they talk about how it's a long tail, right? You're supposed to have a big resistor here to have a big voltage drop. Well, guess what? It works when I make these resistors bigger than that one. This is only, let me make sure. Yeah, this is a 4.7K resistor. It's smaller. It's still big. This is a big resistor, but it's smaller than those. And yet it makes my circuit work with incredible gain. Don't ask me. But this was the problem I was having, why I couldn't get the circuit to work. I was trying with like 100 ohm here and 10,000 ohm here. I said, well, that's certainly bigger. And it just, nothing. It was all goofed up. I basically made a binary comparator that didn't even compare right. But this works fine. So here's your values. One more thing. This is minus 5 volts. You can have this grounded and have your resistor here and whatnot, but I found it easier to not do that, because if I had a resistor here to have the voltage drop, then I'd have to bias I1 and I2, because if this is 0, and I1 is 0 or negative, remember, it's the same thing. We have to bias a common emitter amplifier. Well, you have to bias that too. But if I use a separate power supply, so I've got a 9-volt wall wart, and then I've got a 5-volt USB cable. So I just hook up. I did a video on this. There's a video on doing a dual 2-power supply transistor bias. So you can look that up for more details, but I just have a second power supply that I've hooked up backwards, essentially, and it's just across this resistor. So you've got 9 volts going to the circuit ground, which is 0, which is not the lowest voltage, it's 0. 9 volts to 0, so when I1 is 0, it's 0. And then I've got hooked up to 0 the 5 volts backwards. So I1 might be 0, this might be minus 5. So I've got, you know, 3-4-ish volts to play with, so that these MOSFETs are always on, constantly on no matter what. Just like the common emitter amplifier, where we have to use the bias to make sure the emitter resistor is above the lowest point that the input is going to go, same thing here. I just do it by making sure the lowest point, so I just have to make sure this signal never goes below minus 4 volts or so, or it risks bottoming out. So that really is the simplest way to do it. And like I said, you can have better constant current sources here, a better constant current source. Sometimes you'll see people do resistors here instead of there and do the outputs in a different way. But I hooked this up, it works, and other than the resistor values, it makes sense. Now, in a way, it makes sense, because a bigger resistor here means this resistor can have more of a swing. So we're trying to get more of a swing here. We want a small signal to make a big signal. So having a big resistor makes sense if all we're doing is voltage. This isn't going to drive a circuit well. You're not going to get any power out of this, but you could hook up another, you know, MOSFET or transistor or something that's controlled by this voltage, and that has the power running through it. But this isn't really for driving something. This is for logic. This is for signal processing. And for that, you don't really, ideally, you'd have no power running through anywhere. You know, all power through a signal processor is just waste. So having big resistor values here doesn't really matter, because we care about the signal, not how much current we can get flowing through here. Ideally, we want zero current, so we just make it as small as possible. But that's it. Make sure the current here is constant. Make this bigger, that goes smaller. Make this bigger, that goes smaller. And the last thing is, we talk about the imperfections. There's something called common mode voltage. Basically, if I1 and I2 are the same, the difference is zero. The output should be zero. If this is 1 volt and that's 1 volt, that should be zero. But it won't be, because things aren't perfect. These transistors, whatever type, aren't going to be atom for atom exactly the same. So one of them is going to conduct a tiny bit more. The other one, they're going to have different curves. If you pick really good ones, they're going to be really close. But they're not going to be perfect. Resistors aren't going to be perfect. Nothing's going to be perfect. One wire is going to be a micrometer longer than the other. So what you get is something called common mode voltage, which is a signal that shouldn't be there. It messes up your signal. It's noise. You can just think of it as noise. It's common mode noise. They call it common because it's common to both. And you might see something called the CMMR, common mode rejection ratio. This is referring to basically how good your differential amplifier or operational amplifier is at not doing this. Basically, it's just how good is it? So there's no mystery to common mode. Common mode voltage and common mode rejection ratio is just how much noise is added by this. How much is noise coming in amplified by this? Because ideally, if you had 3 minus 2 or 2 minus 1, you would get the same number. But you're not going to get the same number. There's going to be slight differences. So ideally, that bias ends up being removed entirely, but it doesn't entirely get removed. So noise that's introduced by the circuit and noise that's not removed by the circuit is your common mode stuff. So it's just a measure of how good it is. So that was long-winded and awful, but I assure you it was much worse for me trying to figure it out in the first place. So let me quickly just show you my circuit in action. I have here my simple circuit. I've got the two 10,000 ohm resistors for the inputs, or not the inputs, but the top near the positive voltage. And I have the 4.7K 4700 ohm resistor down here towards the negative voltage. I've got two N-channel MOSFETs. I'm using, what is it? The 5LN01SP. It's just a generic cheap N-channel MOSFET. And then I have several power supplies. I have a 9-volt wall wart that I will now plug in. I have a USB cable into a wall adapter that I've got in a breakout on here. And I've got my two power supplies here that I will use to simulate the two inputs. So I'll turn on those, and they're both currently set at 0 volts with an overhead of a max 100 amps, 100 milliamps, 0.1 amp, just so the circuit can make sure it's actually getting 0 volts. Now, remember that all four of these I have tested and made sure that there is no common grounding, you know, the actual ground earth plug. None of my power supplies and none of the wall warts are connecting together with the ground plug. They're, well, the two power supplies at least are grounded for safety, but the ground pin is not connected to the negative. My negative output is not grounded to earth. So that way there's no short circuits. If it's all connected somewhere, you're going to short circuit. But if they're all separate, then you're fine. In your own circuit, if you need the second power supply, use something called an isolation transformer, if you can. I'll do that in a future video. For now, I've just got two power supplies. So I will now turn on two of my multimeters to voltage mode. And let me put it on 20 volts so we can see it. There we go. This one on the left is measuring the voltage at the output. In the diagram I had up there, this is measuring 01. So we have the positive, the high, the top, you know, 3 minus 2, this is the 3. And then this is the output connected to that, so that's the bottom. It's the top of the input, the bottom of the output. So this is 01. And then this one over here is measuring 02. So this is the one on the left of the diagram I had, and this is the one on the right. So this one is supposed to measure the top, and this is supposed to measure the bottom of the output. And then this one, wrong way, this one is connecting the two together. These two are connected to the circuit ground. This one is not. The way I have it hooked up, the 9-volt power supply positive is going into the 10K resistors at the top. It goes through the resistor, it goes through the MOSFETs, it goes down here to the resistor, and this down here is my minus 5 volts. So my positive 9 volts is here. My negative 5 volts, the second supply, is here. All I did was flip the wires and pretend positive was negative. Positive is connected to circuit ground. Negative is connected down here. Right? 9-volt positive is connected to the tops of the 10K resistors. The 9-volt negative is connected to circuit ground. The 5-volt positive is connected to circuit ground. The 5-volt negative is connected down to the 4.7K resistor. So that's how I get my total of 14 volts to the whole thing. 9 for the top and 5 for the bottom. And then my power supplies, the left one is input 1 on the left. The output 1 is input 1 on the right. Now these don't generate negative voltages, so what I did is this one's backwards. When I put a voltage on here, it's saying input 1 is going up. So from 0 to 1 to 2 to 3 to 4. If I put 1 volt on here, it's saying that input 2 is negative 1. So input 2 would go 0, negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, and so forth. So this one can only go up, this one can only go down. It's just for demonstration. Right now, both of them are at 0. The difference is close to 0. You see, it's not. This is our common mode error. 1/10 of a volt. That's pretty big, but it's not horrible. And you'll notice here, both of these are at half of 9 volts. 4.5 and 4.5 is 9. And then the 5 volt is just down there at the bottom, serving as the constant current source, the roughly constant current source. So let me go ahead and change input 1, and I'm going to give it just a single 10 millivolts. So I gave it 10 millivolts, but now we're getting about 460 millivolts at the output, the difference. And you'll notice I increased input 1, which increased the voltage drop across that resistor, which decreased this voltage, right? This is below that resistor, so that resistor went up, this went down. And this one went up, because this was at 4.5 before. Let me give it another 10 millivolts. So now it's at 20 millivolts. This is down to 3.88. This is up to 5, and we're up to over a volt at the output. How about I give it 30 millivolts? Now we're at 3.59, 5.29, and 1.67 difference. So a difference of 30 millivolts is giving us 1,670 millivolts actual difference. This is the gain, in effect. And it's positive because the one on the left is the positive input, the higher input, 3 minus 2. In this case, 30 minus 0, but still. Now, let me go ahead and turn this back down to 20 millivolts. So we're at 3.88 and 5 again, 1.10. And now let me turn this up by 10 millivolts. So what happened here is input 1 is 20 millivolts. Input 2 is negative 10 millivolts, because remember I have this one backwards for demonstration purposes. The difference is 30 millivolts again, and we're getting about a similar number. See, 1.66 here. Let me go back. So that to 0, this one up to 3, 1.67. What if I take this one all the way to 0 and take this one to negative 30? 1, 2, 3, 1.69 difference. Do you see? And if I were to flip this around, I could make it go the other way, but you get the point. It's amplifying the difference, and the errors is our common mode. So if I were to, in fact, let me go ahead and put this back to normal instead of reverse. So I'm just going to flip the positive and negative back to normal the way they should be. And yes, it's unsafe to do this while the circuit's running. Oh well. So you'll notice our common mode changed because there's noise from diodes and all kinds of other nonsense, but we're still roughly getting a 0. So now, if I turn this up to 30 millivolts, we get our 1.66, which is close enough. If I do the other one instead, now, see, this one is hooked up correctly. This is a positive. So I put that up to 3, we get minus 1.9. So that's not perfect, but it's on the order of. So now I've got 0 minus 30, because that's a positive 30 now. And you see these voltages are opposite. This one went up and that one went down instead of the other way. We're getting a negative. Now what if I turn them both up to 3? So they're both at 30 and now we're back to close to 0. But it's not the same 0. It was 0.10, 0.11, but now it's 0.15 or 0.15 if you prefer. So it's not exactly. So 30 minus 30 is giving minus 0.15. 20 minus 20 is giving minus 0.09. This is your common mode rejection ratio, which for this thing I've cobbled together is obviously abysmal. What if I do 5? So that's 50 millivolts minus 50 millivolts give us minus 0.06. The difference, it's amplifying the difference. And the difference is 0, so it's close to 0. And that's all there is to it. So now let me correctly turn everything off. And there we go. This was just a lead up into operational amplifiers, because an operational amplifier kind of works like this in a more complex way. And I'm still studying that. Operational amplifiers are sort of a ubiquitous component. I may make one myself someday, but I think that's going to be a more advanced project. I've looked at the circuit diagrams and they are complex. Meanwhile, for a few dollars, I got 50 of them. So we'll just treat this as a little black box and get into more details later. For now, I'll be seeing you.